In this session, actually, I am shifting from whiteboard to PowerPoint presentation. So I really want a real feedback from all of you, whether you prefer whiteboard or PowerPoint presentation. So this time I'm going with the presentation, placenta. So before you view this session, I would like you to view my previous sessions on the development in the first week, second week, and third week, so that you will get a continuity with the topic. So placenta, as we all know, it has got a fetal side and a maternal side. It is a discoid organ. The fetal side where you get the attachment of the umbilical cord, and the maternal side which is rough. We will be coming to the details of placenta. So in this session, I will be dealing with the functions of placenta, the decidua, what do you mean by the development of placenta, about chorionic villi, placental circulation, then placental barrier, the classification of placenta, and about abnormal implantation. Coming to the functions of placenta, the main functions of placenta are meant for nutrition, respiration, excretion, and the formation of placental hormones. I'm not going into the details of functions. We will be dealing with the anatomical aspect of placenta. So let's see. We have already seen about the fertilization and implantation in detail. And it's about on 6th or 7th day, the blastocyst stage is getting implanted onto the uterine wall. When we think about placenta, most of us, even I, believe that it is just getting attached onto the uterine wall. But when we think about implantation, I've already mentioned, the blastocyst is actually getting absorbed into the uterine endometrium. That is what is happening. It's not just getting attached. The entire blastocyst will be getting absorbed or getting impregnated into the uterine endometrium. That is what is actually happening. Then further stages, what happens is it is completely in the uterine endometrium, and this is the nick through which this blastocyst entered into the uterine endometrium. And once the implantation is complete, the nick through which the blastocyst entered the endometrium is actually plucked by a fibrin plug. So the entire blastocyst is now within the uterine endometrium. It's not just hanging from the endometrial wall inside the uterine cavity. It is just embedded within the uterine endometrium. This view you should always have. This view should be cleared before you deal with the placenta. Now what happens is, as the fetus enlarges, this protrudes into the uterine cavity. That is what is actually happening. So we have the uterine cavity like this, and this fetus with development, it protrudes into the uterine cavity as the amniotic cavity enlarges, so that the decidua, that is the endometrium, is renamed after implantation. So what do you mean by decidua? The endometrium to which the fetus or the growing fetus is attached, this is called decidua basalis. The rest of the fetus along with the amnion and chorion are covered by the endometrium again. That region, this green colored region, is called decidua capsularis, and the remaining endometrium which lines the remaining uterine cavity, this is called decidua parietalis. That is what is meant by decidua. The endometrium after implantation is renamed. The part to which the fetus is getting attached to the uterine endometrium, that is called decidua basalis. The remaining fetus is lined by the endometrium, that is what is meant by decidua capsularis, and the rest of the uterine cavity is lined by endometrium, and that endometrium you call it as decidua parietalis. And as the amniotic cavity enlarges, this fetus will be occupying the entire uterine cavity along with the growth of the fetus. So now we can see that there is no space called uterine cavity. The entire uterine cavity is now occupied by the fetus and the amniotic cavity. So what is actually happening is, you had the decidua capsularis, which is mentioned by the dark green color, and the decidua parietalis here. So these two layers actually got fused, and the uterine cavity is ultimately obliterated. So when you look through the cervical os, the internal os, you can see that you have the decidua parietalis, the decidua capsularis fused at the parietal regions of the internal os, and then you have the chorion, and then you have the amnion. So we have all usually we have usually the gynecologists say when they pass fingers through the internal organs, they will feel the bag of membranes, and it is this bag of membranes which usually rupture in case of a premature delivery as well as during labor. And when this rupture, the amniotic fluid will gush through the os and the fetus will be following that gush. So what do you mean by the amniochorionic membrane? So it is nothing but the decidua capsularis, then you have the chorion, then you have the amnion. So all together is what is meant by the membranes, the amnion, chorion and decidua capsularis. All together you call it as the amniochorionic membrane, or the membrane which is actually rupturing during delivery. So the uterine cavity is actually obliterated by the fusion of decidua capsularis and decidua parietalis. So where is the placenta? Placenta is that part which is adhered to the endometrium at the decidua basalis. So we will be coming to know the details of the formation of placenta. So when we talk about development of placenta, this is the stage at which the implantation is complete. When the implantation is complete, there are two major portions for the embryo, that is the embryoblast and the trophoblast. So at the end of first week, at the beginning of second week, the trophoblast is getting actually differentiated into two layers, the outer syncytial trophoblast and an inner cytotrophoblast. All these details I have dealt in detail in the previous sessions, please go through it. And we also have a mesoderm which is lying outside the embryoblast. This is called extraembryonic mesoderm. So extraembryonic mesoderm, you have the cytotrophoblast and you have the syncytial trophoblast in the beginning of second week of development. Now what happens? We can see that there are many spaces developing in the syncytial trophoblast. These spaces are known as lacuna spaces in the syncytial trophoblast. Now what happens to these lacuna spaces? These lacuna spaces are now gradually filled by maternal blood which is coming through spiral arteries. So in the second week towards the end, we can see that the lacuna spaces in the syncytial trophoblast are filled with maternal blood from the uterine spiral vessels. And this is the time or first time of establishment of uterofetal circulation. And we simultaneously we can also see that in the extraembryonic mesoderm, there are many spaces developing. They are called exocoelomic clefts, which are actually fusing to form extraembryonic coelom or chorionic cavity. So at this point, I would like to mention the two layers of the trophoblast. They are the cytotrophoblast, the inner layer, and the syncytial trophoblast, where you get the lacuna spaces. Though when the lacuna spaces are formed, we can see some strips of syncytial trophoblast lying between the lacuna spaces. These strips of syncytial trophoblast are known as trabeculae. So the syncytial trophoblast remaining between the lacuna spaces are called trabeculae. And what do you mean by chorion? That is the next question. So chorion is nothing but the extraembryonic mesoderm. Now we can see that the extraembryonic coelom is actually completely formed by the fusion of the clefts in the extraembryonic mesoderm. So the extraembryonic mesoderm, to be exactly speaking, it is a somatopleuric layer of the extraembryonic mesoderm with the trophoblast together, what is known as the chorion. So chorion is nothing but the somatopleuric extraembryonic mesoderm plus the trophoblast, the two layers, the cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast. All together, you call it as chorion. So, till now we have mentioned the syncytial trophoblast with the lacuna spaces filled with maternal blood, and in between we had the strips of the syncytial trophoblast which are known as trabeculae. In this stage, towards the end of second week, what is actually happening is, you can note some cells are actually proliferating from the cytotrophoblast layer through the trabeculae towards the periphery. You can see radiating cells from the cytotrophoblast through the trabeculae towards the periphery, and when they reaches the periphery, they are actually joining with the neighboring group of cells to form an outer shell. So this invasion of cytotrophoblast into the syncytial trophoblast is marked as the formation of primary chorionic villus. Why this is called primary chorionic villus? We have already mentioned that this is the chorion, that is the extraembryonic mesoderm plus cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast. So anything growing from this chorion is called as chorionic villi. So this is known as the primary chorionic villi. So primary chorionic villi means when you just take a cut section at this region, you can see that in the center you get the cytotrophoblast and periphery. All these are cylindrical structures, okay, and we are just taking a section. We are just taking a coronal section. So when you take a section here, you can see in the middle the cytotrophoblast and periphery you have the syncytial trophoblast. So this is known as the primary chorionic villus. The formation of primary chorionic villus is what is happening towards the end of second week of development. And when these cytotrophoblastic cells form or go towards the periphery, they are forming an outer shell similar to this circle of cytotrophoblast. So this outer layer is called as the outer cytotrophoblastic shell. Now that the primary chorionic villus has already formed, the lacunar spaces filled with maternal blood are actually lying between the two villi, the primary chorionic villi. So we can rename the same lacunar space as intervillus space. So from this point onwards, the lacunar spaces filled with maternal blood is known as intervillus space. So up to the formation of placenta, the nutrition to the fetus or the growing embryo is provided by diffusion from the maternal blood to the fetus. But after the development of placenta, the villi will be acting as the exchange material between the fetus and the mother. Now we are moving on to the third week of intrauterine life. So what is happening in the third week of intrauterine life? We can see that the extraembryonic coelom is actually, the size is actually getting depleted due to the enlargement of the amniotic cavity. So this is a narrow cleft-like space which is known as the chorionic cavity. Then we have already mentioned the extraembryonic mesoderm, the somatopleuric extraembryonic mesoderm. At this stage, what is actually happening is this extraembryonic mesoderm is trying to penetrate into the cytotrophoblast layer which is passing through the trabeculae. So this stage is known as secondary chorionic villi. We have already mentioned the primary chorionic villi. So this stage, the invasion of the extraembryonic mesoderm into the cytotrophoblast is known as formation of secondary chorionic villus. So when you take a section at this level, in the centermost point, you will be getting the extraembryonic mesoderm surrounded by a layer of cytotrophoblast and which is again surrounded by a layer of syncytial trophoblast. So that is what is actually happening at the formation of secondary chorionic villi. So primary chorionic villi, you had the cytotrophoblast in the centermost position. When we move on to the secondary chorionic villi, in the centermost position, we have the extraembryonic mesoderm. Now, as the development continues, we can see that this narrow space, this narrow white space of the chorionic cavity, it is actually almost getting depleted at the expense of growing amniotic cavity. And this is the umbilical cord through which the fetus is getting attached to the uterine wall. And in the umbilical cord, we can see the umbilical vessels developing. Once these umbilical vessels are formed, they will try to invade these secondary chorionic villi. So if you take a section now at this level, the centermost point, you will get the umbilical vessels or fetal vessels surrounded by the extraembryonic mesoderm, which is surrounded by the cytotrophoblast, which is surrounded by syncytial trophoblast. So the entire thing, with the centermost position being held by the fetal blood vessels, is now known as tertiary chorionic villi. So these are the three stages when we talk about the development of placenta. These are the three stages of development of chorionic villi: the primary chorionic villi with the center formed by the cytotrophoblast, secondary chorionic villi where the cytotrophoblast is invaded by the extraembryonic mesoderm, and tertiary chorionic villi where the where the center is invaded by fetal blood vessels. So these are the three stages of chorionic villi formation. Now we can see that this is the umbilical cord through which the fetus is getting attached to the endometrium. And this pink colored region, that is actually the chorion, is actually well developed at the decidua basalis. And the remaining part, which is covering the entire amniotic membrane, is actually degenerating. So this part which is covering the amniotic cavity is called chorion leaf, and the part which is actually developing as the placenta proper is called as chorionic frondosum. So chorionic frondosum, because till the stage we mentioned about the formation of villi throughout the circumference of the fetus, but as the development proceeds, only this part at which the formation of placenta is meant to be, that region is actually developing as placenta, and the remaining chorionic villi will degenerate, and the remaining thing will be seen as a very smooth surface covering the fetus, and that is known as chorion leaf. So this is chorionic frondosum, which is developing as the placenta proper, and the remaining chorionic villi which is degenerating is known as chorion leaf. Now if you take a section, so this is the placental attachment through the umbilical cord. If you take a section through this level, what all things which you can see? So let's see what all things you can see. So this is the umbilical cord attachment, and this is the maternal surface, and this is the fetal surface. We have already seen that the fetal surface is the surface onto which the umbilical cord is attached. The other portion is known as the maternal surface. So when we talk about the structure of placenta, we can say that it is just two plates connected by the villi. It is just two plates connected by villi. So which are the two plates of placenta? One is known as basal plate, which is seen on the maternal side, and the other one is called chorionic plate, which is towards the fetal side. So these two plates are actually connected by the villi, and the villi are separated by intervillar space. So this is what is actually the structure of placenta is. So let's see what do you mean by a chorionic plate. So chorionic plate is nothing but the extraembryonic mesoderm with the fetal blood vessels, the cytotrophoblast and syncytiotrophoblast. Altogether, we call it as chorionic plate, which is actually lined by amniotic membrane. And what do you mean by basal plate? When we look from the maternal side, we can see the decidua basalis. Then you have the outer syncytiotrophoblast. Then you have the outer cytotrophoblastic shell. Then you have another layer, the inner layer of the syncytiotrophoblast. So these all together with the decidua. Decidua plus the two layers of syncytiotrophoblast, and in between you have the outer cytotrophoblastic shell, all together forms the basal plate. So these two plates, the basal plate and the chorionic plate, are connected by villi, and the villi are separated by intervillar space. That is roughly what is meant by the structure of placenta. Now we have already mentioned that it is a discoid organ with a fetal surface and a maternal surface. Fetal surface is actually identified by the surface onto which you have the attachment of the umbilical cord, and maternal surface is actually identified by an irregular surface with the many lobed structures. These are known as cotyledons, maternal cotyledons. There are up to 15 to 20 maternal cotyledons, and these cotyledons give an irregular or rough look to the maternal surface of placenta. And these two plates are connected by villus. So the placenta, according to development, we have mentioned the formation of primary villus, secondary villus, tertiary villus and all. And according to the villus, according to the structure of the villus, we can say the villus which connects these two plates as the stem villus or anchoring villus. And from this anchoring or truncus or stem villus, all these are the names given to the villus which connects these two plates. Anchoring villus, truncus, chorae or stem villus, all these are names given to the main villus which is connecting the basal plate and the chorionic plate. From these you can see many branches arising. They are called ramus cori, and from this we can see many finer branchings which are actually floating. This entire thing is the intervillar space. So many finer branches are actually floating in the intervillar space. They are called ramuli cori or floating villi. So this is the structural classification of the villus, and the developmental classification is primary villus, secondary villus and tertiary villus. Now I would like to point out two important things. One is maternal cotyledon and the other one is fetal cotyledon. When we look at the basal plate of placenta, we can see that the decidua is trying to invade into the fetal part as placental septa. So these are called the placental septa, the decidua which is trying to invade into the fetal part. These are called as placental septa. So the region between the two placental septa is actually known as maternal cotyledon. Region between two placental septa. So what do you mean by maternal cotyledon? So it is the region between two placental septa which includes two or more, sometimes it may include two or more stem villi, and they are intervillar spaces. So a maternal cotyledon includes two or more stem villi along with the intervillar spaces. So is there any fetal cotyledon? Yes, there is. So fetal cotyledon is nothing but a single stem villus along with the fetal blood vessels in it. So fetal cotyledon is a single stem villus along with the fetal blood vessels in it, whereas maternal cotyledon is the thing lying between the two placental septa which includes two or more stem villi with the intervillar spaces. Now a little bit about the placental circulation. Each intervillar space is roughly estimated to include 140 ml of blood, and about 500 ml of blood is estimated to circulate through each intervillar space in a minute. So 500 ml roughly, the circulation will happen up to 4 times per minute, because each intervillar space is actually accommodating 140 ml of maternal blood. And as this circulates, you have the uterine blood vessels in the form of uterine artery and uterine vein, and the uterine artery will be carrying oxygenated blood and uterine vein will be carrying deoxygenated blood into the intervillar space. But in case of umbilical vessels, you have the umbilical artery and umbilical vein. We can see that this blue colored is actually artery. Why is this blue colored as shown as marked as artery? Because here it is the umbilical artery which is carrying deoxygenated blood from the fetus, and it is the umbilical vein which is shown as red in color which is carrying the oxygenated blood from the mother to the fetus. So this is what is happening in the fetal blood vessels, and actually the umbilical cord consists of two umbilical arteries and one umbilical vein. So in the initial period, say in the first trimester, if you take a section of this villi, this is how it looks like. You can see the trophoblastic layer, we have the extraembryonic mesodium, and you have the fetal blood vessels, that is a tertiary chorionic villi. So what do you mean by a placental barrier? Placental barrier is nothing but, you just imagine you are standing inside the fetal blood vessel. You are just standing inside the fetal blood vessel and you are trying to see the maternal blood. What will happen? You will get something in between you and the maternal blood. So that is what is meant by a placental barrier. So if you are imagine you are standing in the fetal capillary and you are trying to look at the maternal blood. So what are the structures coming in between you and the maternal blood? So first thing which you will be seeing when you are standing inside the fetal capillary will be the endothelium of fetal capillary. Then you have the extraembryonic mesoderm. Then you have the cytotrophoblast. Then you have the syncytial trophoblast. These are the four layers which you get in the first trimester. And the fetal blood vessels will be more or less arranged within the center of the developing villi. Now as the placental villi matures towards term, for better exchange of nutrients and gases, the fetal blood vessels will just relocate its position towards the periphery, and on its way it will try to move off the extraembryonic mesoderm and the cytotrophoblastic layer so that it comes closer to the syncytial trophoblast. And at this point, if you stand inside the fetal capillary and look at the maternal blood, actually the membrane is made more clear and you will be seeing only two layers. Previously we mentioned four layers, that is the fetal endothelium, extraembryonic mesoderm, cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast. But at this point you will be getting only two layers, that is the fetal endothelium and the syncytial trophoblast, whereas the cytotrophoblast and extraembryonic mesoderm at this layer will be actually degenerated. So this is actually a schematic representation. This is actually a section of villi at first trimester, and we can see that the placental blood vessels are more or less towards the center, and you have the extraembryonic mesoderm, you have the cytotrophoblast and you have the syncytial trophoblast. So fetal endothelium, extraembryonic mesoderm, cytotrophoblast, syncytial trophoblast, these are the four layers in the beginning, and towards maturation we can see that the blood vessels, fetal blood vessels, are relocated so that it comes closer to the syncytial trophoblast. So these two layers, this green layer and yellow layer, actually is vanishing, and the capillary is coming closer to the syncytial trophoblast. At this point the placental membrane is actually made up of fetal endothelium and syncytial trophoblast, only two layers, as the villi is getting matured. Now coming to the classification of placenta based on shape, we can see two disc-like placenta in some cases. This is called as bidiscoidal. Now if it is not in the form of a disc and it is appearing as lobes, this is called lobed placenta. Sometimes it is just getting attached as a diffuse format, it is not in the form of a disc, so this is called diffuse placenta. Sometimes a part of placenta is separated from the main disc, this is called placenta succinturata, placenta succinturata. Sometimes there will be a hole in the placenta, that is called as fenestrated placenta. And sometimes you can see a decidua, some part of decidua actually overlapping the entire placental disc. A part of decidua is actually forming or overlapping the entire placental disc. That is known as circumvallate placenta. So the disc decidua is actually forming or encircling the disc in the form of a lip. That is known as circumvallate placenta. And depending upon insertion of the umbilical cord, it is having yet another classification. This is a normal mode of attachment where you get the umbilical cord attached almost to the center of the placenta. Sometimes it is getting attached to the margin, then it is called as marginal placenta. Now in this case what is happening is the umbilical vessels are actually dividing before it enters into the placenta. This is called furcate type of insertion. And sometimes what is happening is the umbilical vessels are getting attached to the amnion before it is getting inserted into the placenta. This is called as velamentous insertion. So this is normal type, this is marginal type, this is furcate, where it divides before it reaches the placenta. And this is velamentous insertion, where it is first getting attached to the amnion, then finally getting inserted to the placenta. Now depending upon the penetration of uterine wall, the classification is like this. Normally what happens is the placenta is actually penetrating only the superficial layer of endometrium. We know that the wall of the uterus is made up of three layers, the innermost endometrium followed by myometrium and the outermost being the perimetrium. So the innermost endometrium, again the superficial aspect, is actually invaded by a placenta. Suppose it is actually penetrating to the deeper aspect of endometrium, you call it as placenta accreta, and that is actually getting penetrated up to the level of decidua, the deeper aspect of decidua basalis. If that is penetrating to the myometrium, the second layer of uterine wall, you call it as placenta increta, and if it is reaching up to the entire thickness of the uterine wall, you call it as placenta percreta. Coming to the abnormal implantation, we normally say that when the placenta is implanted in the upper uterine segment, we consider it as normal. But if it is getting inserted or implanted in the lower uterine segment, we call it as abnormal implantation or intrauterine ectopic pregnancy. So this is otherwise known as placenta previa. So there are mainly four grades of placenta previa. Grade 1 means, or first degree means, the placenta is actually getting implanted in the lower uterine segment. Grade 2 means it is reaching up to the internal os, but it is not covering the internal os. Grade 3 means it is covering the internal os, but when the os is dilated, it won't be covering the internal os. And grade 4 means it is completely covering the internal os, whether it is dilated or not. So these are the four grades of abnormal implantation. So we have seen placenta in a nutshell. That's about the development of placenta, the structure of placenta, the formation of chorionic villi, the placental barrier, placental circulation, and some classifications of placenta based on the shape, based on the attachment of umbilical cord, based on the invasion of the uterine wall, and something about the abnormal implantation. And that's all about placenta. I really want to get a feedback about the PowerPoint presentation, whether you like PPT or whiteboard. I've covered most of the embryology topics in my textbook, The Life in the Womb. You can purchase my book online, and the details of it are given in the description given below. And please go through it. I really would like to get a feedback about my book so that I can redo the book once again in the next edition. Thank you.